Well, good morning, good morning. Good to have each of you here this morning. Look, good looking crowd. A lot of red out there. Is that symbolic of something? Christmas? We got several things we need to get done this morning. Let me start out with, though, and this is, it's tough, it's sad, but on the other portion, Dean Fogle, some of you know Dean, Dean and Jan, they're very active in the church, a real tall fella with white hair. He had a massive stroke last night and some bleeding in the brain, and they don't think he'll live through the day. But you know what? He'll be with the Lord. He knows the Lord very well, grew up in church, and knows we do need to pray for his wife, Jan. She's also in the hospital. She's got the flu, and they're in the same hospital in Colorado Springs. So I just wanted to say that so we could start out with a word of prayer. And again, it's difficult, but yet because they know Jesus Christ, we can rejoice in the fact that God's taking care of things. So let's start out with a word of prayer. Father, we come this morning thanking you that you watch over us, starting with creation as you created each one of us, then giving us salvation through your Son, Jesus Christ, preparing a place for us where we can live with you eternally. And we do pray for Dean this today as he's going through this thing. Just be there and just do whatever needs to be done. You know best. Be with Jan, though, and give her comfort. May we as a church remember to pray for them and to give them comfort. Be with our service this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Several other announcements that we need to make you aware of. Of course, choir is going to be doing their cantata this morning. Next Sunday night, the orchestra will be doing their program. And after the orchestra's program on Sunday night, we have a time of fellowship with cookies and so forth. We encourage you to bring some cookies and we'll go over to the fellowship hall and just enjoy that time together. We will not be having service tonight. There is the Light is doing a concert over at the E Free Church, and it's to support Loaves and Fishes. That's at 6 o'clock tonight. They're doing a concert over at the E Free Church, and so we ask you to participate in that if you'd like to do that. There are other announcements in your bulletin that you need, of course, to be aware of, the various things that we're going to do. This coming Saturday, this is also in your bulletin, Carl Cruz, who has been a deacon in this church for many, many years. He went home to be with the Lord last week, and there'll be a memorial service this coming Saturday here at the church at 1 o'clock. So a lot of things in your bulletin, a lot of things to thank God for and people to pray for. We just finished our 50th anniversary. I guess we're still kind of in it this year. And we had a lot of people write and say congratulations and so forth. But we had one more that we want to show you this morning.
This is Franklin Graham. Congratulations to Pastor David and Cañon Community Baptist Church. 50 years of ministry. Hey, that's quite a milestone. And I just want to say thank you for being a light in your community. Thank you for your support of Samaritan's Purse and Operation Heal Our Patriots, Operation Christmas Child. We just wouldn't be able to do the work we do around the world if we didn't have partners like you. So thank you and God bless each and every one.
Most of you know who that is. We appreciate that from Franklin Graham telling our church that she appreciates us and congratulating us on 50 years. Who knows how the Lord's going to work and what he's going to do, but we're looking forward to this next coming year. So we're going to have our ensemble sing at this time.
Angels say.
announcements or things they need to make you aware of. Of course, Christmas cards. We've got boxes in the back. If you bring Christmas cards for the church folks, and they're divided up alphabetically, and you can just drop them in the box, and then they're sorted out and put on the tables back in the lobby. So after church this morning, you might want to check there and see if you've got some Christmas cards out there. But if you bring some, just put them in the box during this week. Also, we have our calendar, and we'd like for everyone to take one, even those of you that are visitors. There's calendars on the back there. There's also a pen that goes with it. Make sure you get that. Then we have a lot of Christmas tracts. If you'd like to get some Christmas tracts and put them in your Christmas cards that you mail out and so forth, there's plenty of these back on the tables in the back and so forth. And so make sure that you pick all of those up. So they're for you to use, to take, and hope that you'll do just that. Ushers, if you'll go ahead and come forward, and we'll have a word of prayer in just a moment. Take up our offering, and then the choir is going to do their cantata this morning. Let's go ahead and pray for the offering. Father, we come to you this morning again thanking you for who you are. And the greatest gift that we received was your son, Jesus Christ. And now we want to give back to you just in thankfulness. And so we pray as we receive this offering that each one that gives out of a heart of love, care, concern for others. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to men on earth. For unto you is born on this very day a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. That was the news first announced long ago to shepherds on a hillside outside Bethlehem. The Gospel of Luke tells us that a choir of angels sang, praising God, maybe much like this choir has just done, maybe on a day like this very day. At Christmas, we remember the story and the good news that Christ was born. We tell it again because he came, not just to them, but to us. He is our Savior, Christ the Lord. We remember the shepherds because we too have been wakeful, alone, keeping the night's fear at bay. We remember Mary and Joseph because we also have been called to birth the gospel, and we know it requires faith and obedience. We remember the journey of the kings because we have made our own journeys in search of God's promises, and we've been worshipers in his presence. We have brought him our gifts, humble and great. Come with us again as we remember the story of that choir, that hillside, and the stable not far away where a baby lay, a baby boy whose birth meant that the world had forever changed. The story is true. The people were real. Come, find the stable, see the star, feel the night wind on the hillside. Hear again the news. Christ has come into the world. God is now among us. Everything has changed.
Thank you.
God is among us. Everything's changed. But how? You might be wondering. People are still oppressed. Sin still wages its great battle in our souls, and evil sometimes seems rampant in this world. People suffer, and the good news is marginalized. The scriptures tell us that even nature cries out for the day it will be delivered. The world was much the same when the prophet Isaiah spoke this promise: "For to us a child will be born, to us a son will be given, and the government will rest upon his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." Isaiah said it would be good news for the people of God, who for centuries had lived in exile and oppression. And it would be good news for all people, for the Messiah would bring salvation and joy to the whole world. He would arrive, the prophet said, with healing in his hand, and would usher in God's kingdom, a kingdom in which there is justice and mercy, freedom and restoration. Where is this kingdom? You see it in the changed lives of every person who believes in Christ, who takes his free gift of forgiveness and redemption. You see it wherever those of us in whom Christ now lives go out with healing in our hands, offering grace, caring for the broken, speaking out for the powerless, and proclaiming the good news of great joy. Unto you is born a Savior. God is among us. There is justice for the oppressed. God is among us. There is release for every prisoner, every heart bound by suffering or fear. God is among us. There is forgiveness for our past and a hope for our future. Hallelujah! Come with us now to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, where God sent an angel to a girl named Mary, to a man named Joseph, who was pledged to be her husband. Imagine what it was like to hear the news, "You've been chosen. God's plan will be accomplished through you." Well, you don't have to imagine it, do you? For you've had your own moment, your own calling, your own invitation to play your part in God's plan. Perhaps, like Mary, your response was, "How can this be?" For God often asks us to do what we could never imagine. What is God asking of you that seems impossible? In this moment, remember Mary and Joseph who said, "Yes," ask God for their faith to step out in obedience.
Partner.
The news of a king's birth provoked many responses from the people of his day. Those who were looking for his coming welcomed him. Those who longed for deliverance from the present political kingdoms rejoiced. Some doubted, even some of God's people, for he came in a way they didn't expect. One thing is for certain. If a new king had arrived, there were sure to be changes. The Bible tells us there were wise men in the Far East who had been watching for signs, looking for these changes, studying scriptures that were not even their own. So when a new star appeared over Bethlehem, they came seeking this new king, and this news was not welcomed by Herod, the reigning king. Sound familiar? The good news of Jesus Christ gets mixed reviews in our world as well. Jesus himself told us to expect this. He told us to expect opposition, ridicule, even persecution. Yet he does not revoke his claim, Christ is Lord. While the world watches, even in disbelief or opposition, we are called to worship.
Our new Lord came to see how our world. There were shepherds on the hillside. There were angels in the sky. They said, boys, don't you be afraid. This is the night of your life. There's a baby in a manger that the whole world needs to know. It begins here with you. Here's what you must do. Go tell, go tell, go tell, go tell.
What you see?
Sister, go tell your brother too. Tell it to everybody you meet. Tell them you've got good news. Tell about the little baby born in Bethlehem. Tell him his name is Jesus and he's coming to free us. Go tell, go tell, go tell, go tell.
What you see?
Wise men are gonna shout it with the rich, the poor, and the lame. And if they were able, the cows in the stable would praise his holy name.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills.
What do you do once you've heard the good news of Jesus? Go see him for yourself. That's what the shepherds did first. And after they had seen him, they praised God. And then they told everybody what they had seen and heard. Come and see. That's the invitation the disciple Philip issued to Nathanael after meeting Jesus. The psalmist David put it this way, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good." If you don't know this Jesus Christ we've been talking about, whose birth we celebrate this Christmas, then that's your first and most important response to him. Come and see. Know him for yourself. Come and hear his offer of forgiveness. See the love in his eyes. Know the kind of future he has in mind for you. See that he is really everything you've been looking for in life. Ask someone sitting near you, or any of us singing or speaking, tell me more about Jesus. Because that's our role in your life, to tell you what Christ is like, to tell you what he has done for us, how he has come into our lives with healing in his hand, to tell you how he has shown us a future and hope that is greater than anything we could imagine. This world can be a dark and lonely place, but Jesus said, I am the light of the world. He is not hard to find. He has put his light in our hearts so that we might help you find your way to him. Just as God set the star above his stable so long ago, may this be the very day you find your way to a life with him now and forever. One day, every knee will bow and every tongue confess. Every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Christ is Lord. Join us now in response we will offer for eternity.
The Lord is come. Let us
glory to God in the highest. On this very day, everything's changed. For unto you a Savior has been born. God is among us. May you go and tell and rejoice.
Boy, if you hadn't gotten the Christmas spirit yet, you got it this morning, didn't you? But we've got to remember that Christmas is more than tinsel and lights. It's all about Jesus Christ, His coming 2,000 years ago, eventually dying on the cross, and He died for our sins so that we could have eternal life. And I hope and I pray that everyone in this auditorium this morning, you know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. But if you're not sure, if you're not sure that you're going to spend eternity in heaven, see one of the choir members, myself, or somebody, and just say, you know, I want to be sure. I want to know for sure that when I die, my time to die, that I'm going to be in heaven. Because Jesus died for you. He had you in mind. And that's what this was all about. And how we need to rejoice and praise Him. There's a lot of evil stuff going on in this world. There's a lot of heartache, and as we mentioned some things this morning, but you know what? Jesus Christ is the ultimate in giving us blessings, praise, glory, and so I trust that you'll do that. Would you just bow your head this morning for just a moment? And I want you just in the quietness of this room, let the Lord speak to you. Let the Holy Spirit speak to you. What do you need to do right now to have your relationship right with Him? Father, we thank You that You thought of us when You came to this earth, spent 30-some years on this earth, and eventually let Yourself go to the cross, and You shed Your blood, and You died for our sins, that we might know that we can have eternal life by accepting You as our Savior. And I pray that everyone in this auditorium has done that. They know for sure, beyond any shadow of a doubt, that they're going to spend eternity with You. If there are some doubts in their mind, let them get it taken care of this morning. Find somebody, talk to them, and say, I want to know for sure. And in Your word, in the Bible, is what we need to hear and see. Thank You. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I've got Steve who wants to come up and give you a little announcement this morning. So, Steve?
So I started a journey with the Lord back in July of this month. I had a call from the church in Cotopaxi, just up the road, 35 miles, and they were without a pastor. They'd asked if I'd come in and just fill the pulpit for a couple of weeks, which I did. At the time, we were kind of talking about, you know, there's no pastor here, and would you be interested? I told them, well, yeah, possibly. In the meantime, they had a couple of other guys come in that filled in for about 6 weeks. And then they called me back and they said, our people really want you to come and be our pastor and candidate. And I accepted the call to, or I accepted the challenge to go candidate. And that's why I was gone 2 weeks in November. The church last week voted to have me come as their pastor, and it was 100% unanimous vote that I would come. You may be thinking, what happened? Am I mad at somebody? Am I mad at Pastor David? Did something happen in the church? Absolutely not. As a matter of fact, we've been here for 12 and a half years, and every day has been wonderful. And this man right here has been the best man I've ever had to work for. And he treats his staff really well. But there's a group of people in Cotopaxi that are hurting. They need a pastor. And God has placed it in their heart to have me come. God has placed it in my heart. After 12 and a half years of being here, that's hard because you're my family. You're Elisa and I's family. We love you. We're going to miss you. We start in January. So I'll be here through this month. Help Robbie out in the band. The drummer, little drummer boy. but I ask that you pray for us because we really love you guys. And but God has opened a new chapter in our lives, and we're excited for the challenge, the call that God has placed on our lives. One thing I can tell you, that I will continue to preach the whole truth of the Word of God. I will not water it down, just as I preached it here, just as my mentor has preached it here. I will preach the truth of the Word of God every Sunday. You can count on that. But pray that people will be saved, pray that people will grow in the Lord, and we're just excited, but we love you guys, but we'll be here the rest of the month, so God bless you.
Steve is leaving, but we're not letting Lisa go. You know, really, when it started, when he started looking, is when I started growing this beard. He said, I can't work for a pastor that has a beard, so, oh, he's leaving. What we want to do on the very last Sunday of the month, that'll be their last Sunday with us, is we want to have a potluck dinner, big luncheon and so forth. And if you want to bring some cards and so forth, that's great. We'll have several of you give testimony. As he said, he was here 12 and a half years, and what a help he's been. Both of them have just been tremendous. We've got a good staff that works together, and Steve and Lisa are a big part of that. And so be in prayer for them as they go. We're also going to need you to step up. There's a lot of things. I told Steve when he was thinking about doing this, I said, write me a list of what you do. About 3 pages long, typewritten. I showed it to the deacons, and they said, what do you do, Pastor? I said, make sure that Steve does these things. But anyway, some of you, we'd like for you to step up and do some of these things. It'd be a good ministry for you. And so if you can do that, it'd be great. We'll be letting you know some of the things that we're looking at having you help us with and so forth. But the last Sunday of the month, we'll have our time of acknowledgement and thanks to Steve and Lisa for being here. And so, meanwhile, be praying for them and the transition and all that. Be praying for our church, too, that we get things worked out here. I'm going to have Don Anderson come up and dismiss us in prayer. Don and Steve have been very close, and Don pastored many years up in the Where'd you pastor, Don? Across the way, didn't you? And they've been very close. So I want Don to dismiss us in prayer. Again, let's give the choir a hand of applause. Usually we dismiss them and let them go out to the lobby, but with all the tables and stuff that's out there, there's no room. So if you want to thank them, come up and thank them. Also, we got a little gift for you as you go out. Tina Hoffman made some bookmarkers for you, so the ushers will have that. And you go out, you got a bookmarker, and calendars and stuff are all there. Don, dismiss us in prayer, please.
I've got to say that I have a lot of sadness. I love Steve. We've been good friends. He's a good man, loves the Lord. And I know what he said, that when he said he's going to preach God's word without compromise, I know that's the truth. He's a man of God. We love him dearly. And we're going to miss him and Lisa a great deal. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, in one respect, we rejoice. Rejoice that the servant of God is being called to a pastorate that he believes is your blessed will. And so, Father, we go with him in spirit. The fact that we love him, love Lisa, love the ministry he's had here for these many years. And God, we just pray that you would increase him greatly and that the love of God would flow through him and to the congregation there, and that many would be saved, edified, and rejoice and glorify the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. So go with him, encourage him and Lisa, and may they be used mightily by the Spirit of God for your glory, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.